Hey everyone, and welcome to the first of what will be many videos that are going to walk us through the Ace Marine Science syllabus. So we're going to be starting with the first, or one of the first units, which is going to be Marine Ecosystems and Biodiversity. And this is video number one. So it's going to deal with ecosystem organization and relationships. We're going to simply look at some of the basic terminology so that we can better understand ecosystems as a whole, and then take a look quickly at some of the relationships that form within ecosystems. So by the end of this video, there's a couple of learning objectives you should be able to hit. The first one is going to be A off the syllabus, which is explain the meaning of the terms ecosystem, habitat, population, and the others that you see here, as well as you should be able to describe some of the interrelationships within a marine ecosystem, two of them specifically being symbiosis and parasitism. So let's go ahead and get started. Now, before we can understand ecosystems as a whole, we should understand how they are organized. And we're going to find that ecosystems are organized from a small level, and then we can get broader and broader. So we start at the smallest level of organization. That's the species level. You can't get any smaller than that. Every ecosystem is going to have species living within it. And all that we mean by the term species is a group of similar organisms that can reproduce with each other, but also produce fertile offspring. And I point that point out because there are some cases where different species, for example, a tiger and a lion might be able to reproduce, but then we find that the result, the liger, is unable to reproduce. So they have to be able to produce fertile offspring. So an example of this in the marine environment would be, let's say, the skipjack tuna, or Katsuwanus palamus. Now, I probably just butchered that scientific name, but I just wanted to remind you that every single species is going to have a two-part binomial name. The first name is going to tell us the genus that it belongs to, and the second name tells us the species. So for us as humans, our scientific name is Homo sapien. The skipjack tuna is Katsuwanus palamus. Now, another thing to mention when it comes to species is that species are all going to have a very specific role inside their ecosystem. And that role we call a niche. Every species has a niche. So one that you might be familiar with off the bat, let's say, is the great white shark. Well, what is its role in its environment? Well, one niche that you might know of is that, well, I just ate my skipjack tuna. It is an apex or top predator. So every single species that we talk about, you're going to find has a very particular niche or role that it fulfills within its ecosystem. Now, if we take a bunch of individuals of the same species, let's say tons of skipjack tuna, now we're at the next level of organization. We call that a population. So all that is meant by the term population are organisms of the same species that are living in that same geographic area at the same time. Now, what we'll find is that populations are adapted to specific geographic areas, and that area is what we call the habitat. So something that you'll see later on in this unit is that when we talk about habitats, species are going to be adapted to those habitats. So an example would be, let's say, a hydrothermal vent. The community of organisms that live down there are unlike anything else that we find anywhere else in the world, and that's because it's a very unique sort of habitat. It's high pressure, no sunlight, tons of heat coming out of those vents, toxic chemicals. So the skipjack tuna would not be able to live there. They're not going to live in that habitat. Their habitat will be much different. Now, going even wider outside the population, if we get tons of different species living together in the same habitat, let's say like that hydrothermal vent community, now we get a community. A community is all the different species living in that same geographic area at the same time. So a different example of a community might be, let's say, at the rocky shore. We're going to notice that this habitat is made up of a community of organisms that are really adapted to that particular environment. So, for example, we could talk about the mollusk community. Now, mollusks are all different species that share some characteristics, like many of them have shells. So, for example, clams and oysters and sea snails, but they all make up that community of that habitat because they are adapted to it and live together at the same time. Now, once we talk about the habitat with the community of organisms, that's where we get to the widest level, which is the ecosystem. An ecosystem is a system, not only of the organisms or the community that lives there, but also those abiotic or physical and chemical factors that affect them. So here we have from the smallest scale species all the way out to the ecosystem, which again is the living and non-living components all working together. Now, when we take a look at all of these things, we can kind of sum all them up and give them some sort of value when we look at all the differences. So you might be familiar that there are all different types of ecosystems, different communities of organisms. Even within a population, there's genetic diversity. And the term that we use to kind of sum all that up is the term biodiversity. We're going to see this again later in this unit, but for now, just have an understanding that this word biodiversity, bio meaning life, and diversity meaning differences, it's all the differences of life. And what we'll find is that some areas or some ecosystems have high biodiversity while some don't have as much, and we'll take a look at why that might be. Now, within ecosystems, now that we understand how they're built, we're just going to briefly look at some of the relationships that are formed within these ecosystems. There can be two types of relationships. We can talk about intra-specific relationships. The prefix intra just means inside. So in other words, within one species, there are relationships that form. Two popular examples would be, let's say, competition, if you're fighting over food or fighting over a mate, or even cooperation, if you're working together for the benefit of, let's say, the colony. But then there are also inter-specific relationships that form. Again, inter now just means between. In other words, between two different species. Some examples of that might include, again, competition. Let's say you and another species have a very similar niche. You might compete over food or territory. Or you might have these other relationships like symbiosis, parasitism, commensalism. Now, if you're not familiar with these terms, don't stress. We're going to focus on just out of all these relationships, two of them, and that's going to be symbiosis and parasitism. So when we talk about a symbiotic relationship or symbiosis, I just want to point out that there are two different definitions that you might come across. One more popular definition of a symbiotic relationship is really any relationship between two different organisms, regardless of who benefits and who doesn't benefit. So it's kind of like an umbrella term. For the sake of this course, we're going to use a symbiotic relationship to mean specifically a relationship between two different organisms of two different species where both derive a benefit from the relationship. Sometimes we call this mutualism. For this course, we're just going to call it a symbiotic relationship or symbiosis. Now, you should be able to give some examples of symbiotic relationships, so let's take a look at a few. One example, a popular one that we'll see again and again, is the relationship between corals, an animal, and zooxanthellae, which are photosynthetic algae. Now, what happens in this relationship is the zooxanthellae live inside the corals, and they're going to get home, they're going to get protection, and they're also going to get some of the raw ingredients that they need to do photosynthesis. Specifically, they're going to get carbon dioxide and water from the corals as they respire. In return, the zooxanthellae are going to do photosynthesis, and they're going to give off those products to the corals, two of the products being oxygen as well as the sugars that they make through photosynthesis. So here they're both benefiting out of this relationship from each other. Another example would be cleaner fish and grouper. Cleaner fish, like the wrasse that you see here, the tiny little purple guys, they're going to pretty much pick off the parasites, the bacteria, as well as the food inside the teeth of the grouper. So they're getting food, and in return, the grouper is getting cleaned up. It's going to have good dental hygiene. It'll have less parasites because they're getting picked off by those cleaner fish. So again, both are benefiting. And then a third example is between tubeworms and chemosynthetic bacteria. Now, this is a symbiotic relationship down at those hydrothermal vents again. And pretty much it's very similar to the corals and the zooxanthellae. The chemosynthetic bacteria are going to do something called chemosynthesis, where they're making their food, this time out of chemical energy instead of light energy. So they're going to live inside the tube worms. Again, they're getting some protection, as well as the tube worms are going to take in the things that the chemosynthetic bacteria need. And in return, the tube worms are going to get the sugar, as well as, primarily the sugars and other organic molecules that the bacteria are making. So again, both are benefiting from that relationship. Now, what happens in a relationship if one oversteps its bounds or even is completely selfish? Well, that's where we're going to get a parasitic relationship. A parasitic relationship is just a relationship between two different organisms where one, the one that we call the parasite, is going to obtain some sort of benefit, and that's going to be at the expense of the other organism, which we call the host. So a couple of examples of this in the marine environment would be nematodes and fish. Nematodes are going to be these worms that get inside the intestines, and there they're going to start reproducing, but they're also going to start feeding off of the host. So the fish, whatever they happen to populate, is going to be at the disadvantage because they're going to be nutrient deficient, and in some cases it can kill the host. Another example would be fish lice. Fish lice, just like normal hair lice that we see in humans, are going to be these organisms, specifically crustaceans, that are going to latch on the outside of the fish and are going to pretty much drain the blood of nutrients. So again, taking away the nutrients from the host, which can eventually kill the fish. Now, just two terms I wanted to throw out there. Because nematodes or roundworms live inside the fish, we call these types of parasites endoparasites, endo meaning inside. While the fish lice, because they latch on the outside, we're going to call these guys ectoparasites. So an ectoparasite lives on the outside, while an endoparasite feeds off the organism from the inside. That's really all there is to this video. So by this point, you should be able to do two things. Again, you should be able to explain the meaning of these terms that you see here, and not just be able to recognize them, but really be able to give a solid definition. On your ACE exam, you should be able to define them from nothing. So have a really good understanding about what these terms mean. And you should also be able to describe these interrelationships. So what is symbiosis versus parasitism? And also provide a couple of examples of each. If you can do both of those things, then I think you're in great shape. If you feel a little uncomfortable, feel free to go back and rewatch any parts to get a better understanding. Thanks so much for watching.